where it began. I can't begin to know it, but then I know it's growing strong. Good times never seem so good.
Good morning. We are coming towards the end of the season that we tend to think of as Easter, and I thought that today we would have a look at two artworks that can help us to think a little bit more about the narrative of the disciples on the road to Emmaus, which we thought about in our service on Sunday. Perhaps we can look at in a slightly different way this morning. The first picture that I have to show you will probably come as no great surprise to some of you. This is a painting which hangs in pride of place on the walls of the National Gallery in London. It is Caravaggio's Supper at Emmaus from 1601. It's an oil painting and it is a good 2 metres wide and about 1.5 metres high. Now what that means is that when you confront those figures, when you go into the space of the gallery and you see those figures, you're seeing them basically at life size. And this is part of Caravaggio's main aim in this picture, I think, in many ways. He was an artist who was intently interested in making things look as real or as natural or as believable as they possibly could. And so this is a picture which many people love because it seems to invite us into the space. There are figures around three sides of the table, and then there is a fourth side that is left empty, and that seems to be our side. We are in the place of that final figure who could sit down at that table. The table seems to come out into our space. The fruit bowl on the very edge of that seems to teeter a little bit over the side to try and convince us that this is three-dimensional, real space that we can be a part of. So in many ways, the main aim of Caravaggio is to convince us that this is a real event, this really happened, and the miracle which is being depicted here, the miracle of Jesus, who the disciples had thought was dead, reappearing to them alive, is true. Now, if you look at the table there, you can see that several moments of Luke's version of the story have been brought together. Jesus has his hand up in a symbol of blessing. He's blessing the bread, but the bread also seems to have already been broken and laid in front of each of the figures. And at the same time, the disciples have already recognized who he is. So we've got those three things conflated in this one canvas for us. Now, if you remember the narrative, you'll know that there were two companions on the road to Emmaus, and those are presumably the two people who are seated at the table, Cleopas and the other one. And then there's this fourth figure in the picture that Caravaggio gives us, presumably the innkeeper or the servant who is serving the meal to the other three. There's a difference, I think, between the way that Jesus has been painted and the way that the disciples have been painted. If you look at Cleopas and his companion, they've got beards, they look quite rugged, they look like everyday people. They don't look like the kind of saints with their golden halos that you might have expected from a different type or earlier Renaissance painting. Jesus, on the other hand, looks almost otherworldly, I think. He suddenly takes on this appearance of youth. He's got a glowing sort of face, a very smoothed out complexion, no beard, this beautiful silky curly hair, and he looks as though he sort of almost belongs with them, but perhaps he also belongs a little bit to heaven as well. And that would fit, wouldn't it, with the Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, who is able to appear and disappear at will before the very eyes of the disciples. Not a ghost, but certainly of a different realm. So whilst this seems like an image that we should be able to walk into and be part of, actually it's very obvious to us that this is not spontaneous, it's completely staged. Caravaggio has made some very deliberate decisions about how he's going to paint this. The lighting, for one thing, is deliberately falling on the faces of the disciple on the right and on Jesus' face. And the innkeeper on the left has his face still half in shadow. Perhaps he hasn't had all of this revealed to him yet. He hasn't understood. The way in which the arms of the figure on the right are outstretched is important. Those seem quite deliberately to be making the form of Christ with his arms outstretched on the cross, reminding us that this story comes after the crucifixion and is related to it. And then finally, the shadow behind Christ's head. And this is almost the thing that I find most interesting, actually. That's probably the least said about it, but I find it the most interesting. That richness of shadow is not just there to highlight the light. There is a sort of halo of light created by it. But also, if you think about it, a shadow, even though it's not made of any substance at all, it's purely light and dark, a shadow is the thing that will often convince us that something is substantially real. If an object is solid, then it will cast a shadow. And if it's not, then it won't cast a shadow. So a shadow is a key marker for something being physically real. And so this is also contributing to what Caravaggio is at great pains to convince us of, the reality, the believability of this miraculous scene. Now, actually, that shadow and a number of other aspects of the story of Emmaus got me thinking about another artwork, and perhaps particularly that idea of the disciples recognising Jesus in the breaking of the bread. Now, this is a very different piece. This is a sculpture by Anthony Gormley, and it's in the Tate's collection. It's from 1980 to 81, and it's the first of a huge number of sculptures that Gormley has made out of slices of bread. I don't know what you thought it was when you first looked at it, whether you maybe thought it was stone or wood or perhaps even paper, but they're slices of bread. 8,640 slices, to be precise, of Mother's Pride bread, which was a mass-produced processed bread that was very popular in the 1980s. Mother's Pride is actually the title that Gormley gave to the most recent series of artworks that he did in bread. And if you went to the Royal Academy at all last year to see the Gormley exhibition there, you would have seen one of the Mother's Pride series hanging on the wall. I'm showing you one now, Mother's Pride number 5. Now, just that idea of the title of the bread has some kind of connotation or evocation, doesn't it, I think? Mother's Pride. Was Jesus the pride of his mother? Are we the pride of our mothers? What does that title of bread mean? It's sort of a domestic title. There's something about it which implies, even though it hasn't been, that it's been handmade by your mum. It's not really individual, unique sourdough bread. It's cheap, processed bread. But the implications of that name are quite strong, I think. It makes us feel very nostalgic, perhaps, to think about Mother's Pride. Now, the idea of memory and nostalgia is absolutely not accidental for Anthony Gormley, because one of the things that that sculpture quite deliberately reminds us of is a tombstone. Now, usually if you have a tombstone, or a certain genre of tombstone, you might have what was known as an effigy, whereby you have a carved stone image of the person whose body is lying inside that tomb. But that effigy, that image, would stand proud of the tomb. It would be three-dimensional, upwards. Now here, Gormley has chewed into those slices of bread, eaten the slices of bread with his mouth, and he's created a void, a shape, an inverse of the tombstone effigy, really, in exactly the shape of his body. He's eaten his body weight in bread in order to create this sculpture. So in some ways, it's as though there's a void left over in the tombstone here. If we were expecting a tombstone effigy standing proud here, the body seems to have got up out of that block, which in a way is exactly what Christ did, isn't it? He rose from the tomb. And actually, if we go back to Luke's narrative, it's the absence of his body, the space left behind, the void, which is another aspect of the evidence that he's come back to life. Luke reminds us that earlier in the day, the women had gone to the tomb and they had found angels, they'd found an empty space, but they hadn't found his body. A little bit later, some of the disciples had gone to check up on what the women had said. They'd found everything just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And in a way, it's in that absence of Jesus' body that we can start to believe in his renewed presence in the world. So sometimes it's absence, or a flat thing, like a shadow, that can convince us of the presence of something real. Now, Gormley, when he was talking about Mother's Pride, the latest series, commented that one of the things he's interested in is meditating on what human life is. A process embedded in time, he says. Not really a thing at all, but a human body, a human person, a human life, is a process embedded in time. Psalm 39 verse 5 tells us that human life is but a breath. We are like something that exists for a brief moment and then are gone. Now, even aside from this meditation on absence and the void which convinces us of Jesus' resurrection, actually bread is something which is very central, isn't it, to the Emmaus narrative in itself. And that was what got me to this point in the first place. Bread is the way in which the disciples recognised Jesus. He'd said, this bread is my body, which is broken for you. He'd also told them earlier, in John's Gospel in particular, that he is the bread of life. And elsewhere he'd referred to the word of God being the thing that sustains us. Man does not live by bread alone, this is in Matthew, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And actually Jesus had already tried, hadn't he, before they got to Emmaus, to reveal himself to the disciples through the scriptures, through the word of God. He tried to explain to them, using the prophets, everything that had happened to him. And if the word of God is intended to be a form of sustenance for us, I don't think it's any accident either that actually this sculpture looks a little bit like an open book. The double effect of that bed, in inverted commas, opened up that way, looks like a book which is revealing contents to us. Now, it's not until after the disciples have recognised Jesus in the breaking of bread that they suddenly realise, oh yes, actually, we should have recognised him earlier through the word of God. Weren't our hearts burning within us as we walked along with him on the road? Oh yes, we should have realised before. But it took the physical bread for them to come to that conclusion. So how in the world do we end up linking Anthony Gormley and Caravaggio? Well, I think for me, it's through this idea of presence and absence. Presence in the Gormley is very fragile, very ethereal. The body has been there, it's an index of the body, but it's not there any longer. And maybe that seems quite different from the insistence on presence and reality and substance in the Caravaggio. And so in many ways, they are quite contrary depictions of human beings. And if in the Caravaggio there's the real presence of those figures, actually the absence is us. We're the figure that is missing from that image. And that makes me think about the way which at times we might be tempted to feel as though God is absent because we can't see him. Well, firstly, often it's us who are absent, not God, and it's probably worth us remembering that. Maybe we've removed ourselves from his presence rather than the other way around. But secondly, and perhaps more interestingly, Jesus, by being physically absent from a locked down time and place, by not existing in our real space, is able to be spiritually present with each of us across time and geography by the Holy Spirit. And that's what makes him different from us. That's what makes the Jesus in Caravaggio's picture different from the other disciples. That's what makes him God and not simply man. If we could see him before us in our space, he wouldn't be God. And his body would be proof not of a miracle, but of the absolute opposite. And we're to recognise him in the bread of his word and in the effect of his work in and through each of us and the effects and the index that leaves behind. Eppie's going to sing a song for us now, Break Thou the Bread of Life, which reflects, I think, on some of those ideas. And it's worth commenting and congratulating her on the fact that this is the 100th song, I gather, that she has recorded for us since the middle of March when we started this YouTube channel. So here we go, the 100th song from Eppie.